Kia ora and welcome to the front row. Never has the name of this show felt so fitting given the All Blacks squad announced for the Rugby World Cup. Today we're talking shocks, bolters, winners and losers after that 31-man squad was named. Joining me today, Andrew Saville, Scotty Stevenson. Lots to talk about, fellas.
Yeah.
Just a little bit.
I'm going to keep you.
Been so busy he's forgotten his jacket. I need a long drink of water.
This is casual. Well,
nice to see we've finally got catering on the set.
Yeah, no, it was good.
But I think we're still coming to terms with Owen Franks not being in the 31. Although, as the selectors discussed yesterday, Scotty, they'd sort of signposted this during the year that they wanted their props to be more mobile and more attacking.
Yeah, I'm gonna pause you there, because I'm trying to keep you on a tight leash. I've got a structure this morning, and we're going to get to Owen Franks in just a second. Right. First, though, before we get into the nitty-gritty, let's hear from Steve Hansen, who had some words for the unfortunate players to miss the cut.
It was a really tough time in their career. And really, really tough when, in a lot of cases, and the guys that have missed out, it's not because they're not good enough, it's just because we've got so much talent.
So who is in and who's out? Here's a refresher. In the forwards, let's take a look. It's the props that draw the immediate attention. Most of us, of course, thought it would be between Angus Ta'avau and Atu Moli for the fifth spot. Instead, the selectors dumped 108-test All Black Owen Franks. In the locks, Brody Retallick won't play in the pool play, but it's hoped he'll be back from his injury for the quarterfinals, so they're taking a punt on him. A surprise was also sprung in the loose forwards. Luke Jacobson making the cut after just one test, after Liam Squire agreed with the selectors he'd be available for backup if required. Fellas, now you can talk about Franks.
Right.
Yeah, well, look, as Seth pointed out earlier, it has been signposted. They wanted mobility. They gave Owen Franks plenty of opportunity to prove that he'd had that string added to his bow. He's never been that guy, Owen Franks. He's not a ball carrier. He's not a distributor as such. Great scrummager, great line-out lifter, so core roles are excellent. But it's the 108 tests, I think that's the big thing. 108 test matches for Owen Franks. Those five props between them boast 97 caps. Atu Moli has never started a test match. Angus Ta'avau has played seven and only started two. So there are going to be other props in other nations who are looking at that and saying whether there is a weakness or not, they are going to think this is a vulnerability point for the All Blacks.
Those northern teams scrummage for penalties. Will they be licking their chops at the fact that there's no Owen Franks?
They'll just be thinking there's a lack of experience there. Now, Atu Moli is a good prop and the All Blacks have had their eye on him for some time. And Angus Ta'avau, for me, has been a revelation over the last two seasons. So, you know, I'm sure you agree, Kim, those two guys can play the game, but there is an optic issue here. And when you're a Northern Hemisphere team and Owen Franks is not there, you're going to be thinking to yourself, they are light on experience.
Not just light on experience, but also there have been, I suppose, some doubts raised. Well, not doubts, that's probably not fair, to Angus Ta'avau and Atu Moli, but there have been, I guess, concerns raised that when it comes to that very core role, which is the scrummaging, that is where Owen Franks excels. No, he's not as mobile, perhaps defensively he's not as good, but the scrum itself, the set piece, that is where he excels. And do these guys have the ability to fill that gap?
Yeah, I think they do, because otherwise they wouldn't be going.
Because they've got to scrum.
I think from an All Black selector's point of view, they're thinking to themselves, we actually don't lose anything at scrum time with not having Owen Franks there. What we gain by having Atu Moli, Angus Ta'avau in particular, is that extra stuff around the field, which is going to be crucial because they want to play tempo.
And the good news is we do know what they're thinking because we talked about it to them. Here's selector Grant Fox about just how tight that decision was, and he shed some light on the process.
Through the four test matches we had, you know, it was about giving guys an opportunity. Yeah, still trying to win rugby tests clearly, but we also needed to give guys opportunities. And so, you know, OE had his and Nepo had his, and, you know, that conversation went right down to the wire. You know, probably started more robustly after the test match out here and then carried on for another number of days before we finally made a decision.
So it wasn't an easy call, but obviously one that they've been thinking about through the whole international season so far.
That would have been tough, and I think you have to take the All Black selectors and the coach at face value when they say how hard that was, because they are loyalists, these guys.
Part of the furniture, wasn't he, for so many years? And a very, very good player, best prop in the world for a number of years.
Oh, I agree with that.
The other thing is that was pointed out to me yesterday by Grant Fox and Ian Foster, just quickly, it's still 30-odd degrees in Tokyo as we speak. If the All Blacks play seven games, including the final, two of those games kick off after 7 o'clock in the evening. The rest of them are either during the day or 6 o'clock. Those fields are going to be hard. They're soccer fields by nature. the All Blacks will shift the ball and shift the ball quickly, and these are the props they need.
Yeah.
I do want to stick with the front row just for a little bit, because for another prop, it is a dream come true. One of TVNZ's Rugby World Cup reporters, Matt Manukia, was with Nepo Laulala for the announcement. If you missed it on the 6pm news, here's a snippet from a beautiful story with a man who 3 years ago was told he'd never play again after a severe knee injury.
Nepo Laulala, Chiefs and Counties Monarch.
It's a very special moment, and I feel very humbled and honoured to be able to represent our country.
And that is the thing I think you do really want to see with this, because you kind of, you forget in all the analysis and all the cutting of players and who's there and who's the shocks and who's the announcements, that for these guys, this is going to be one of the highlights of their life.
Especially when you've been through so much like he has. I mean, there was a shot in that story of Matt's, the three big scars on Nepo Laulala's knee. His knee was blown apart in training into the Chiefs. And yeah, you're probably right, he shouldn't have played again, or probably, you know, but what an amazing story, and just fantastic to see that sort of emotion.
Exactly.
Carry on, Kim.
No. I was going to give you a moment before I moved on.
I just love these stories, because Nepo's one, and the emotion there is just brilliant, isn't it? Because it's a human story. It's a story of triumph over adversity for a player like that. Same for Brad Webber.
Yeah.
He was nowhere after 2015.
Arguably my favourite story, favourite feel-good story of
this
squad.
We spoke about that at the announcement yesterday, Kim. I mean, wonderful moment for him to be a part of this Rugby World Cup team as well. For Luke Jacobson, you know, he's a young player who's been given a shot. How great for him. And onwards and through that list you go. Paddy Tuipulotu, who came back, Leo McDonald yesterday said, I think he obviously lost a couple of kgs in the small time he was with the All Blacks, and look at the way he played. He had an opportunity put in front of him saying, you can be a part of this squad if you show us what you're capable of. Paddy Tuipulotu in that test match against the Wallabies was sensational. So this is what it's all about for these guys, taking an opportunity.
You mentioned Paddy, because in our progress, let's move into the locks. We're about 7 minutes down. We're only just at the locks. That's fine. Very quickly, Brody Retallick being retained. I mean, Steve Hansen said, you know, we're taking a bit of a punt here, a bit of a risk, because we know he's not going to be available until,
you've got to take him.
I don't think that's surprising.
No.
Great, we won't linger too much on that then, no surprises there.
Can I just remind you that Richie McCaw played two World Cups basically with a dud foot, and the last World Cup in 2011 Rugby World Cup, they took a player and he wasn't available to the quarterfinals as well.
Brody Retallick will play the quarters onwards.
Guaranteed. Yeah.
Great, heard it here first. Oh, there is to it. Let's go to the Lucys. The big news was that Liam Squire did make that call to Steve Hansen, and they agreed on him being a replacement. That realistically, effectively made space for this year's bolter, one test All Black 22-year-old Luke Jacobson. Here's Steve Hansen and Ian Foster.
It doesn't matter if you've had one or none or 100, I guess. If you're good enough, you should be available for selection.
Some guys, you just take a hunch on that you think, you know, that he looks like he can deal with that pressure and deal with the situation quite easily.
And they did raise the point as well that he, you know, captained the under-20s and things like that. They see him as a very long-term all-black future leader, all of those sorts of things. Have they made the right call here, guys?
Oh, yeah, I think so. Luke Jacobson, to me, he had a rather truncated first experience anyway. Took a knock, and that was pretty much the end of his opportunity through that rugby championship. I stood next to him before the South African test
in
Wellington.
He's a big boy.
He's a unit. There is no doubt about that. And there was a question raised in the press conference yesterday about the size of New Zealand's loose forwards. They're big men. Make no mistake. I mean, Artie Saville, yes, by world standards, might not be the biggest, but neither is Michael Hooper. But how effective is he? That's not about size.
He's not as tall as a Squire, but he's not far off it. And he is built across here.
Yeah.
And what they like about him is that not only is he a good tackler, he's a dominant tackler. In all the stats they get provided with, Luke Jacobson will be and is a very good player and will be a good All Black, very good All Black.
I think some of the context around that discussion, though, was also about the fact that they don't have a kind of, I guess, enforcer-type role, you Jerome Kano type of player, now that they don't have Liam Squire. Do you see that as a concern?
Well, Sam Kane fills that role, and I think that's what people miss most of the time about the way Sam Kane plays the game. If you just watch him in a test match, he makes a tackle, he gets up, he makes the next one, he gets up, he makes another, and that zone around the fringe of the breakdown is Sam Kane's bread and butter. That frees up a guy like Kieran Reid to range a bit wider, and Artie Saville to do what Artie Saville does. I think the balance of that loose forward trio is good. But yes,
long term, I think Jake Jacobson could be
could
that.
Could fill that role. Yep. But the thing about it is that they're not missing out on the dominant tackles at the moment. Don't slip off your chair, Kimbo.
I'm on the edge of my chair.
You are on the edge of your chair. You're so excited.
I don't think they miss the dominance. I think it's a fallacy that the All Blacks don't have a dominant tackler in their loose forwards. And the way Kieran Reid ripped into Australia in that last Bledisloe was insane.
All right, let's move on. That's the forwards covered, I think, fairly comprehensively. Let's go to the back, shall we? The halfbacks, if we can bring that up as expected. Bowden Barrett's still listed as a first five, even though you'd expect him presumably to be starting at fullback as we've seen this international season. With Ryan Crotty's timely return from injury, it means no room for Nani Laumapi in the midfield, and that has been quite the talking point. Geordie Barrett also listed among the five outside backs. Ryan Crotty coming back, I think we all expected it.
Yep.
I think it was well kind of forecast that Nani would probably be the unlucky one, but still, hard break for a guy who's not really put a foot wrong.
Oh, yeah. But it's a stylistic thing for me. They want some guys who are more distributive than Nani Laumapi has proved to be. On his carry stats alone, he goes. Mm. If you're just looking at that metric in his game, he's been dominant. He has made the most metres of any centre in Tier 1 rugby since 2018. That's what he does. He carts the ball up. But you're up against rush defences where you need to be more manipulative in the midfield, and that's where Ryan Crotty's strength is. Jack Goodhue, Anton Leonard-Brown, Ryan Crotty, Sonny Bill Williams, I think, give you an awful lot of variation.
Quite an array, isn't it?
That's it.
The feet
and
head of ALB, the lines of Goodhue and the size of Goodhue. Sonny Bill, we know Sonny Bill. Mm-hmm. Crotty.
The
football intelligence, not saying those other guys don't have it, but as Sumo says, manipulation of a backline which is needed with this defence these days.
So Grant Fox said Lamapi's exclusion was simply a matter of brutal maths, really. You can't fit five into four, and he says he envisages a long All Blacks career ahead.
No way he'd let us down if we took him, but we can't take everybody. And we were looking at balance of skill sets, experience, you know, who can play both positions in the midfield, and then we just had to make a tough call. But again, you know, midfield's a very confrontational area. So, you know, Nani might still get an opportunity yet.
And that's something we haven't touched on, which is the fact that there are going to be injuries.
Well, everyone's picking Ryan Crotty to get injured because he's been injured in the past. I mean, that's ridiculous. That's like saying, I've had three heads now, I've flipped a coin, it's going to be tails this time. I mean, who knows what's going to happen there? Ryan Crotty having that breather through injury could be the best thing that ever happened for him.
What a position of luxury for the All Blacks to be in, to know if something does happen in the midfield, then they've got a guy like Nani Laumapi to come in. All right, let's talk number 10. As expected, only Richard Mwanga and Bowden Barrett named as the first fives, but Steve Hansen says they've got enough cover, so let's hear who those potential replacements would be.
Geordie Barrett, we think, can play there. TJ, we know, can play there. And Ryan Crotty spent a lot of time playing first five as a young player. I think he played in the under-20s or under-19s, as it was back then, in under-21s. And if we had to, I think Ben Smith could play there too. He's played every house.
And you've got Ian Foster.
Please.
You've got Ian Foster. And you've got Foxy in the stand as well.
Honest, you've got Stephen Donald in the
Stephen
commentary
Donald's
team.
In the commentary box with me. We'll be fine. If Beaver has to get called up in the second half of a crutch game, and then he'll be there. I'll make sure his jersey doesn't fit
and
properly.
And I'd back you to play 10 against Canada.
But you cannot be serious sitting in front of a press conference saying anyone in our back line can play 10 in a World Cup.
We may jest, but I tell you what, I would be absolutely intrigued to see a Crotty or a Geordie or a TJ playing 10 against one of these lesser teams.
You've got to look at the equation here. Bowden Barrett is a first five. That's where he wants to play. He makes no secret of that. And just last week, I sat down with Bowden Barrett. I said, are you a 15 or 10? He said, I'm a 10. I want to play 10. I would not be surprised if Bowden Barrett is the 10 during this World Cup in the similar way that they used last time with Richie Mwanga on the bench or vice versa. They've taken five outside backs. They've got plenty of fullback cover. They might just be reverting to type here and saying, Bowden is our man at 10. It would not surprise me. I don't think they need an extra 10.
For those other games you're talking about.
I think they've just got it. I think they've got it covered. I think Bowden Barrett still has a chance to be the starting 10 in this World Cup. Mm.
What do you think will happen? Because Steve Hansen raised the interesting point at that press conference as well, that Richie Mwanga may actually not be fit for their final test before the World Cup. That's against Tonga. He said if it was a World Cup final, he would play it. Mm-hmm. It's not, so TBC. So what do you think we're going to see there? Because all of a sudden, what they've been doing for the entire international season would have to change.
I think we're going to see pretty much the number one team play Tonga.
Yeah, I think they're going to roll out.
And Hansen's forecast that. So if Mwanga is not in that, though, does Barrett then move into 10?
Yeah,
yes.
Alright, well that was easier than
I expected. If they want to trial something against Tonga, and with all respect to Kalitahi, this is not going to trouble the scorers here in Hamilton from an All Black point of view, I don't think. So they may well put someone in there who hasn't played 10 at an international level before just to see how it goes. I don't know. I think this is a real big statement game for the All Blacks. It's their last game at home before a Rugby World Cup. They've got to go out there and actually have the confidence, say Eden Park wasn't an anomaly, that was our baseline performance.
And let's talk as well a little bit about, you know, Steve Hansen alluded to the pressure that they now come under. They're taking 19 World Cup debutants as such. As we've talked about, they've got that kind of youthful mix in there at the expense of some more experienced players. How do you think they will go about handling that pressure? It seems a silly question, I suppose, when you're talking about back-to-back winners going in to defend it for a third time. But what do you think they will be saying to that group of youngsters now going into this?
You deserve it. Now go and play like it. I think that's the whole PR slant from Steve Hansen yesterday. Embrace our expectation. We're expected to go there and perform well and hopefully win a World Cup. So go out there and play like it.
I think what Hansen said was good in the spiel before or just after the team was announced. The fact that the All Blacks face this sort of pressure every time they play, and some teams up north don't face that same sort of pressure that the All Blacks always face. Good bit of needle there.
Yeah.
I
think it was more for his players' benefit than anyone else's. I really do. I think that's the statement within that team now. We are the most dominant team in the world. We have been for a decade. Let's put a full stop on a decade of dominance, go out there and be the number one team in the world.
I just got the feeling yesterday, too, that the there was a lifting of a shroud. The 31 has been named.
Let's get on with it. Yeah.
This is the World Cup now.
Just lastly, before we go, I do want to finish it on a very positive note.
Good.
So, your favourite feel-good, I guess, story of the team selections? You already know mine, it's Brad Webber. That's no surprise. I have sprung this on you. I haven't given you time to think about it, have you?
Well, I love Nepo's story, La La La. Atu Moli, that horrific leg injury of his, whereas it was and Brad Webber could have gone overseas like that.
100%.
Exactly, the way he's stuck it out. Yeah. Angus Ta'avao as well. I mean, he's talked about
he's
how he was on the verge
a lot,
of giving up.
Went to Sydney, came back.
Yeah. I'll tell you mine, and it's Matt Todd.
Oh, yes.
2013, he made his debut for the All Blacks. It's now 2019. Since 2013, he's played 20 test matches, only 5 of them as starts. He has been a weapon for Crusaders and for Canterbury for his entire career, including the most amazing final he played this year in Super Rugby. If there's any bloke who deserves a chance to finish his New Zealand career on a high, it's a guy who's given his all and has got no credit for the things that he's done.
All right, I love it. Let's leave it there. Thank you very much, guys. That's it for this week. What a week it's been. And no doubt some of those discussions, those controversies will continue right up to the World Cup. Thank you, though, for being with us, and do join us again next week. See you then.